very good at this. Yeah. And therefore, for us to be able to communicate our thoughts to others or preserve them for our future use, signs of ideas are also necessary. Now, it is not hard to imagine that for centuries, philosophers were intrigued by the idea of one's thoughts being directly accessible to another, that is, without one's wishing in any way to communicate them to the other. Now, it is perhaps because it appears to be so improbable and so implausible that this idea is found mostly in the works in the genre of speculative history of philosophy. Now, the thinker most often associated with the notion of the ability to read the thoughts of others is Descartes, which is hardly surprising given the privileged status of thought in his metaphysical theory as the principal attribute of the mental substance. Now, one such work of speculative philosophical historiography is a slim booklet by someone called, let me see, just a second, by someone called Pierre Daniel Huet. Pierre Daniel Huet, entitled Nouveau Memoirs, that is to say, New Memoirs for the History of Cartesianism, which was published pseudonymously and with no imprint in 1692. Now, this is highly satirical piece of writing focused on a traveler with a bent for Cartesian philosophy who has heard rumors in his travels that in Lapland there is a stranger teaching Cartesian philosophy with such authority and confidence that even Descartes could not have done it better himself. Now, since Descartes has officially been dead for several years by then, the traveler decides to visit Lapland to investigate the rumors on the spot. Now, and it transpires that the learned stranger is none other than Descartes himself, who did not really die in February 1650, but only feigned his death. Now, in what follows, Descartes recounts for the benefit of the inquisitive visitor through a dialogue with Pierre Chenu, who was a French ambassador to Sweden, in whose house in Stockholm Descartes staged his own death. He recounts the series of events which brought him to Lapland. Now, disappointed as he goes on, disappointed by the lack of understanding of his teachings, by the ridicule and contempt with which his metaphysical theory was received. Now, to give you just one example, for example, the medicine Descartes' valet brings him one day from the pharmacist is wrapped in a piece of paper, in a piece of paper, which Descartes recognizes with horror as a page torn out of his meditation. So he decides to withdraw to the extreme north, to Lapland, where he expects to find a much more receptive and appreciative audience for his metaphysical theories. Now, he hopes to find a peace and solitude there and to be able to devote himself to contemplation and study of nature. At the time, Lapland was obviously considered a mysterious but pure and pristine land, far from the traps of civilization. Now, Descartes says he has always felt a strong inclination for the countries of the far north. Now, as well as the natural phenomena such as long summer days without night and long winter days, the nights without day, the northern lights, termed, of course, Aurora Borealis,